So my name is Jonathan Betz Zall, and as Mary said, I have been doing peace and justice work around the environment and justice for a long time. I've organized and participated in countless peace demonstrations and served on several nonprofit boards, including the Community Coalition for Environmental Justice. And this is just a small part of the board with whom I served. We're just take a look at the diversity there. Yeah, this is truly was an inspiring experience to be part of that. This organization has now folded itself into Got Green, which is going very strongly basically ensuring that people of color can find jobs in the new green economy. But they've also recently taken on climate change because they know about the issues of climate justice, that is, the disparate impact, the greater impact that all these environmental disasters, especially climate change, have on people of color, poor people, as opposed to the richer people who can get away or live in places that will be flooded later. But now I'd like to introduce myself in a different way. My name is Jonathan Betz Zall. I'm a member of the Ashkenazi Nation. This slide shows where we lived for almost 1,000 years. Is that big enough for you to see? You see where that is? It's Central Europe. Yeah, the kind of purplish-reddish area, that is the Duchy of Lithuania. Can you see the little red circle on there? That's where my father's parents came from. It's a place called Brest-Litovsk. It's a slightly different name in Polish, which is what it's on. This map is from the Polish government, so all the labels are in Polish. But it's still pronounced Brest-Litovsk. Anyway, and then my other ancestors came from Austria, which is kind of down off the map to the south. Now, why am I not still there? Because various European oppressors, first the Russians from the east, and then the Germans from the west, kicked them out. Basically, they fled for their lives and landed on the east coast of the US, and eventually I came to there. My parents met in college in Philadelphia, where they also sent me when I was old enough. And that college experience turned me into a social change activist, just like these people. These are students at the college I attended, Swarthmore. And this is actually from this year. They are trying to get the college to divest from fossil fuel. But when I was there, the big cause was the Vietnam War and then pollution in the early 70s. Now, what information does that second introduction give you that the first one did not? Let's think about that for a minute. Okay. Racial or ethnic heritage? Okay. In Europe, I would not be considered white. Even now. Yeah. Family experience with social injustice? Okay. Sense of personal history and involvement with issues. Okay. So what I'm trying to do is something like the way Native Americans introduce themselves when they speak, when the ones who are kind of culturally traditional will introduce themselves in a way that links them with their audience through what is meaningful to them. Now, I'm an academic, too. I teach at Highline College, teach environmental science and library stuff. When I introduce myself there, I give my degrees, because that's what they're into, okay? If I were a Native American person, a lot of what people are interested in is who are you related to, and what land do you come from? So if I were a Native American person, I'd be saying, you know, I descend from these people, and my people have always lived on this particular piece of land. But I wanted to do kind of a European-American version of that, just so you'd see how it'd be like to think a little bit differently than we usually do about these kinds of issues. Okay. Starting a little differently than usual, right? Okay, so let's go on ahead. So 20 years ago, in April 2003, I gave a presentation to this group, Seattle chapter meeting, on why peaceniks should care about the environment. This talk covered a broad range of environmental concerns, including FOR's own statements and some talk among military-minded people of environmental security, and reported on one of CCEJ's conferences on environmental justice. Only one Native American speaker was mentioned. Okay. But today, the environmental movement has changed a lot, largely because Native Americans have discovered their power to influence energy policy, specifically the shipment of energy resources to Asia, and because largely white environmental organizations have finally realized that they need to support these people in their struggles rather than co-opt them for wilderness preservation. Thanks to organizations like Idle No More, we can recognize that Native Americans or First Nations people, through their shared ethical outlook, offer us an opportunity to break away from our dominant society's existential threat to Earth's life systems by upholding FOR's own tradition of spiritually based activism for a nonviolent future. That's my professor voice. And I want to add on to that. In the blurb for this program, I said, how can we adjust our own lifestyles? Well, I want you to think really broadly about lifestyles. Okay, what does lifestyle really mean? It's not just, do you drive a car or not? It's more, it also includes at a deeper level how you're relating to the Earth as a whole. And if I have time, I'll show you a little exercise that we do in my class. So this is the Facebook page for Idle No More Washington, which is, I want to read, can you read the quote? Is it readable? No? Okay. Sorry, this thing didn't come out as large as I hoped. We stand in solidarity with our First Nations brothers and sisters and allies for treaty rights, water and land rights, and environmental protection of Mother Earth on the sacred land of our ancestors, decolonization, and keeping our native culture going strong. As our elders taught us, what we do today is not for us, but for our children and our children's children. So this is actually, this is a demonstration, this is one of the first Shell No demonstrations at Jack Block Park, before the kayaktivists actually got out on the water. And these folks are part of a larger movement called Idle No More in general. This is the from the Facebook page of the Canadian originators of the idea. It's even more explicit about what this movement wants. Our people and our Mother Earth can no longer afford to be economic hostages in the race to industrialize our homelands. It's time for our people to rise up and take back our role as caretakers and stewards of the land. Caretakers and stewards of the land. Okay. That's a little different from what environmentalists mean by that. Environmentalists tend to mean preserve and keep humans out. As I've come to understand it, the Native American view is to take care of it actively, manage it for maximum life productivity, and to live off it. For example, when, after many years of exclusion, someone whose people had lived on the Olympic Peninsula came back and saw what was there now, after all this time of human exclusion, she burst into tears saying, they have not taken care of this place. They have just let it grow wild. Okay. And so on the Facebook page, they're quoting Wanda Nonnybush, Indigenous peoples are on the front lines of climate change. We will be here for you, defending the land. Will you be here for us, defending our rights? Okay. Why is such a strong commitment to the land? Anybody see the Sunday paper this morning? Front page story? They were featuring this guy, Brian Kladusby, who's the chairman of the Swinomish tribe, Swinomish tribal community. That's a picture of him. And he's actually on the beach you know, right there at their main cultural center, and the structure behind him is a structure, one of three structures they built to host the canoe journey just a couple of years ago. I went out there and volunteered and had a blast. But what he's saying, and this is not in the newspaper article about him, but it is in the video that's on the Seattle Times website. "We do not inherit this land from our ancestors, we borrow it from our children. The Swinomish has been living in this area since time immemorial. We cannot just pick up and leave. We've got generations and generations and generations of tribal members that are buried right here in this earth. And so our blood flows really deep into these lands." Now, you remember, my part of my ancestor story was people got uprooted and sent away for fear of their lives. Okay, so we don't have the opportunity to defend land the way these folks do. So I'm highly motivated to help them. I didn't get that chance. I want to be sure that they do. So here's what they're doing. Can you read that? At least the headline. "Swinomish tribe sues to block Bakken oil trains." This is from April 5th. "A deal is a deal," said Swinomish Chairman Brian Cladusby in a statement released Tuesday. "Our signatures were on the agreement with the railroad company, and so were theirs. So was the United States. But despite all that, the railroad company began running its Bakken oil trains across the reservation without asking and without even telling us." So land grabs, resource extraction, and general exploitation are not things of the past. Still happening this very minute. The railroad company's response was, "We're studying this." The following month, tribes take a stand against oil export terminal, again from the Seattle Times. Tim Ballou II, chair of the Lummi Indian Business Council, raises his hands in praise of nine Native and First Nations tribal leaders who came together Thursday to sign a declaration urging the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers to refuse permitting for a coal terminal at Cherry Point near Bellingham. Leaders from the Lummi, Yakima, Tulalip, Northern Cheyenne, Quinault, Spokane, Tsleil-Waututh, Lower Elwha, and Swinomish tribal communities were represented. The Sierra Club helped facilitate the event. And then they named the people. Behind Ballou are Otto Braided Hair, Northern Cheyenne, Reuben George, Tsleil-Waututh, Melvin Sheldon Jr. from the Tulalips, Joe DeGoody, Yakima, and Tuale Abrahamson, Spokane. Notice not only the variety of nations represented, but also that they were supported, not led, by environmentalists. So, did you notice the reference to the Sierra Club's involvement? Here's a section of their website, Power Past Coal. It says, "Enough is enough. Stand with the Lummi against big coal. It's long past time for the proposed largest in North America coal export proposal to be denied. As you know, the Lummi Nation began the new year by formally requesting that the U.S. Army Corps of Engineers deny a permit to build a coal export terminal in Whatcom County because the impacts to tribal fishing cannot be mitigated. To approve the permit, the tribe argues, would be a violation of their treaty rights." Now, I've got to give Sierra Club credit. As I said, they have learned their lesson of the past, where in the past, you know, they would just use Native faces to raise money for themselves. Here's their action page related to that, Power Past Coal Action. And unfortunately, it's too small to see, but this page actually says, please contact your representatives right now. And if you click on, you put your zip code on there, and then you click on submit, and that's what it takes you to. It takes you to a letter that you can send to your senators, okay? No fund appeals, no put me on your mailing list, nothing like that, okay? It actually is doing what they should be doing. So I've written to my legislators supporting the Lummi's position, and I'm on the lookout for other opportunities to support the tribes. But I'd like you to encourage you to think more broadly about how our lifestyles support the oppressive system, even when we verbally oppose it. Here's another comment from Sweetwater. I forgot to mention earlier. This is Sweetwater Nanook. I actually met her, as it says on here, I actually met her at Occupy Seattle in 2011, where she turned out to be one of the major spiritual leaders of that whole thing. Every time she spoke, it was something about, let's consider the spiritual side of this. Okay. She was always calling for people to broaden their perspective. And when conflict threatened to arise, she said, let's pray the hell out of it. Okay, so on the picture it says, I talked to an elder talking about the colonizers coming here. I said, so what happened to them when they got here? He said, the colonizers have become colonized. So just think about that for a minute. A lot of the people who came in feeling themselves oppressed as immigrants, the Irish, the Jews, the so-called hunkies who are Hungarians, a lot of other people from Eastern Europe, they formed the labor unions in the early 20th century. Where are they now? Their children and their grandchildren are probably feeling pretty satisfied with their lives, not thinking about where they came from. They think of themselves as just plain Americans. And therefore, they are willing to do whatever it takes to keep their own lifestyle going. Does that sound like colonization to you? I think it does. Taken over, co-opted, made a part of the system. There we are. So, just this past week, the Pope came out with a wonderful statement. And a number of environmental groups and others have been very encouraged by what he said, including me. I can't say I've read the whole thing. I've certainly read parts of it. I actually took this particular quote, which I'm sorry it's so small, from Indian Country News, which is the main media outlet for kind of activist Native Americans. Let me try to read this. Many intensive forms of environmental exploitation and degradation not only exhaust the resources which provide local communities with their livelihood, but also undo the social structures which, for a long time, shaped cultural identity and their sense of the meaning of life and community. The disappearance of a culture can be just as serious or even more serious than the disappearance of a species of plant or animal. This imposition of a dominant lifestyle linked to a single form of production can be just as harmful as the altering of ecosystems. Okay. You know, he said a lot of other provocative things, but this is the one, you can see why the Native Americans picked right up on this. So, who's to blame? All of us who've been colonized, unless we question it. Quakers, of whom I'm one, have a fairly similar perspective, although we tend to frame it more in terms of social injustice and less in terms of the environment. There's one guy, if there ever was a Quaker saint, it was this guy, John Woolman, who in the 1770s, 1760s, came to realize that slavery was wrong, even though it was quickly becoming the economic basis of the whole South. And a lot of people in the rest of the country also held slaves, including many Quakers. But rather than berate them, rather than tell them they were evil people who were keeping people in bondage, he just went to visit them and slowly worked on them and changed a lot of people, essentially through spiritual means, just like Sweetwater talked about praying the hell out of the problem. John Woolman did that too. But this is probably his clearest statement that relates to this specific situation. Oh, that we who declare against wars and acknowledge our trust to be in God only may walk in the light and therein examine our foundations and motives in holding great estates. Estates are like land property. May we look upon our treasures and the furniture of our houses and the garments in which we array ourselves and try, that is examine, whether the seeds of war have nourishment in these our possessions or not. So this is 18th century language. Let me try to translate it into 21st. Basically, everything we have comes from the earth, one way or another. If it can't be grown, it's going to be mined. And that means that the conditions under which those resources are obtained have a lot to do with how other people live. If we don't pay attention to where these things come from, and if we want more and more, no matter whether we care whether they came from or not, we are oppressing other people because they will be exploited to supply us by the system. That's what he means by the seeds of war. If we're engaged that much with our possessions, we just have to have them. You know, we're authorizing war. And so this picture is a cartoon from this Quaker blog. It's a gift to be simple, but you can see it's a household where a lot of the stuff's kind of worn out, but there's just too much stuff piled up everywhere. So that's the joke in the cartoon. Okay. So if you want to get free of that system, there's lots and lots of resources. This is one from a group that used to be called Alternatives and is now called Simple Living Works. Alternatives became famous about 30 years ago for proposing a lot of alternatives to celebrating Christmas through consumerism. And they published several very successful catalogs convincing people, you know, to do things that matter rather than give a lot of frivolous gifts. So now they're online. This is their front page, and they mostly actually operate through a blog that has what are called podcasts, which are basically sound recordings you can get through the internet. And they have lots and lots of lectures on how to make your life better by consuming less. I described it as one of many resources for simplifying lifestyles using extensive social media, including blogs 3 times a week and podcasts 2x a month, to show that living more with less is a faithful, satisfying, and effective way to live. Live simply that others may simply live is not a life of fads, convenience, nor deprivation. So I ask, could we actually live in a non-exploitive way? This is actually from NBC News. Dan Price crouches to enter what he calls his Hobbit Hole house, which he built into a hillside in the small town of Joseph in northeast Oregon. Using scrap wood, he spent $75 to build it, most of that paid for fasteners and sealants. The living space is 8 feet across and shaped like a circle with 4 feet high sloped ceiling. The things I need are food, clothing, shelter, said Price, who lives on about $5,000 a year. Adopting a life of radical simplicity, he said, stopped all of my worrying about money and jobs. And I put the website on there in case anybody can see it, but there's lots of other pictures that show just how happy he is with that life. And it looks all neat and clean. You know, this is not dirty, grubby, messy stuff the way my house is. Okay, but I want to go beyond. This is actually kind of a traditional message for peace people. We've heard it a lot probably over the years, right? Okay, so again, my question is, could we really reduce our standard of living? Maybe we just need to rethink what standard of living means for us. Okay, so I came across some more nice websites with cool pictures on them that explore this idea. A lot of these are drawn from my experience in visiting with Native Americans, which is why I feel justified in throwing them into this talk. First, I want to talk about the Duwamish tribe. The Duwamish tribe are the ones who occupied the land right around Seattle. Most of what's now Seattle was occupied by the Duwamish. Some in the kind of the northern part was Snohomish. This is a painting on the left It's kind of an idealized member of the tribe from that period, right before white contact. The person on the right, his name is Ken Workman. He's a frequent spokesperson for the tribe, although I don't know whether he actually holds specific office except being on the council. But he's often quoted. He's a pretty handsome guy, very well spoken, and has some other interesting ancestry, including also being related to the guy who invented the Red Delicious apple. Because I went and heard him talk about that once. So he's not 100% full blood, but he's certainly culturally a member of the tribe, completely accepted. And he does claim Chief Seattle as his great-great-grandfather. The Duwamish Longhouse is the tribe's cultural center and museum and gift shop and place where they hold many, many cultural educational events. And one of them is here on the screen. I'm sorry it's too small for you to see, but this is actually coming up next week. So, yeah, Sunday, June 28th, 12:30 p.m. It's an educational program on Duwamish beach plants, most of which are edible. So if you're interested in more simple living but didn't want to go whole hog like the guy with the house in the hole in the ground, you could go to a program like this and find out how to simplify your food supply. Not so dependent on supermarkets. Even the wonderful PCC, which I do dearly love, it's still part of that industrial change. They get all their food comes on these big diesel trucks. You know, and in addition, if you're not into gardening or you're not any good at gardening, you know, you can think about things like this. Now, if everybody did this, you know, all the wild plants would be gone. So it's not something to really depend on, but it does point us in a direction that we could go. Okay, and if we were serious about it, if our society as a whole was serious about it, we could dedicate enough land that people could wildcraft and survive on it. We just don't have the space right now. So I just friended the Duwamish Longhouse on Facebook, and so every so often, when they're putting on an event, I hear from them. And sometimes I've gone. And one of the cool things about it is they recognize expertise no matter who has it. You do not have to be a member of the tribe or Native American to come and speak there, because the other time that I went, it was a European-American woman from Snohomish somewhere who was a total expert at certain kinds of recipes with wild plants. And she was freely sharing them. I got there late, so I didn't catch the beginning of it, but everybody was really into it. And that's the other point I want to make about the Duwamish Longhouse. They are extremely welcoming and friendly, no matter who you are. And they will feed you, whether you pay for it or not. This is not the Western expectation, right? You know, they do ask for contributions, of course, so they can keep going. But it's not on that basis. The museum, you know, you go to Mohai. They want big bucks to get in there. Okay, I'm happy to pay it. It's a great museum. But you go to the Longhouse Museum, they definitely would like your contributions, but there is no compulsion about it at all. See a difference? A whole different spirit about it. No expectation that people will be selfish or greedy. The expectation is people will be generous. And you can bet the people who come in there feel that and respond. So on May 30th, Rosie and I went to a wonderful presentation called The Living Breath of Wushtabaf, which is a conference on indigenous life ways held at the University of Washington. And this is just to show you what, I'm sorry, let me read what I said. It's much more coherent. They hosted a fabulous conference on native food cultures, including lots of opportunities to taste local delicacies. The organizers are academics, so the conference sessions followed academic lines. This is one of the flip charts from discussion of traditional values as expressed in food culture. Now, yeah, that is too small to see, but they have, here in the center, they have food sovereignty there, and around it are the seasons, fall, summer, I guess that's spring and winter. Past, present, future, time is alive. It's not a dead thing. You don't have to stretch it out and measure it. It's alive. We're constantly interacting with it. Up here, where's my mouse? There. This area is, you know, all these areas are important and connected, but this is the one that really, really got to me, because it's talking about relations and community. Who are you related to? Is it only the humans? Family, grandmothers. Then it says, how are we connected? Remember our relatives. Responsibility, maintain our relationship with the center. Treaty rights, competing responsibly for resources. Dealing well with conflicting values. I guess it's best full spectrum of treaty rights. I guess there's disagreement on what the treaty rights are, so they want the best full spectrum to make sure everyone's included. Then there are other areas on the chart that are interesting too, but those are the main ones I wanted to highlight. It's the idea of connection and of sharing and of being responsible. So what do we have in the culture that most of us live in? That the Native Americans who are trying to uphold their traditional culture also have to live in. Okay? We all know what it's like. We all feel the pressures of, you know, being drawn to Fred Meyer and being, you know, fawned upon there because we have money to spend. At least that's what they think. If they don't think you have money to spend, they might look at you differently. Well, I lived through the late 60s. I remember some of the social experiments that were tried. And some of them are still going on, quite successfully, I might add. Okay. This photo is from a website called Fellowship for Intentional Community. These are people who want to live in a different way than the two-parent, two-child, white picket fence house that's all isolated from everyone else. These folks want to live in larger groups where they develop ways of cooperating with each other and having assumptions something like the ones that we just experienced with the native culture at the Duwamish Longhouse. So here you see people enjoying some kind of ceremony. And you can see they're all holding up each other's hands. We do this in FOR from time to time, right? Okay. So on one of the blogs that's associated with this group, I found this wonderful quote. This is from an article about putting our lives on the line, that is hanging up your clothes on the clothesline. And towards the end of it, she says, it can hardly be called heroic work to put our lives on the line this way, hanging laundry on a clothesline rather than using a powered dryer. In fact, in this age of productivity and efficiency, it could seem more foolish than valiant. But the daily task of hanging laundry forces us to slow down, and it keeps us connected to the earth, to one another, and even, if we keep our hearts open, to God. So I wanted to end on that one, because that is something that we are actually doing now. You know, Rosie and I have run Bright Morning Star now for in its present location for almost 30 years. And we have a large number of alumni who are still practicing what we're doing on a larger or smaller basis. As the initial introduction mentioned, we're completely solarized as much as we can. But we still use way too much power. Okay, we're still trying to do better. Okay, we only produce about 60 to 70% of the energy we need in the summertime, thanks to our solar panels. Okay, yes, our utility says it's green, but they're using hydropower. Hydropower kills salmon. And they can mitigate for that. Okay, they can mitigate for it, but it's still taking energy out of the system. In our household, we practice cooperative decision-making and nonviolent conflict resolution methods. And it works really well. Fortunately, we're all culturally similar enough that assumptions don't get in the way too much. Okay. It would be harder if we were more diverse. But again, another challenge for the future. Okay. I can't say we haven't backslid. But we have done some fairly radical things, like have no car. Our entire household of six adults has no automobile. We do use automobiles, but we rent them when we need them. Okay. So my point is, because we're really focusing so much, we're not specifically focused on supporting Native Americans and doing all these things. It's mostly, you know, living the values that we want to live. We want to be cooperative. We want to live as lightly on the earth as we can. And we want to be cheap. But in doing that, we are objectively supporting the Native Americans. You know, leaving space for their lifestyles, pulling back from the exploitive American way of life as it's been defined. Okay. There was an active campaign in the 1920s to get people to consume more because there was a production crisis after World War I. And manufacturers were afraid that people would not buy enough stuff to keep them going. So they promoted what later came to be called planned obsolescence. Okay. And thanks to people like alternatives, who I mentioned earlier, we started to come to realize that with the advent of the hippies. And now, over time, over the last 30 years, we've been able to pull ourselves out of it, at least somewhat. So that is what I mean when I say, let's adjust our lifestyles to be supportive and in solidarity with the Native Americans. Let's be responsible for ourselves. It's not up to them to tell us what to do. It's our responsibility to take that on and do everything we can to live lightly on the earth. That's what I was going to tell you. I'd be happy to talk about it more if you have questions. Okay, other questions? Discussion? Anybody disagree with anything?
I was interested, you talked about the man who lived in a house that was constructed in a pit in the grass.
Right.
My grandfather was a homesteader in North Dakota when he first came here from Eastern Europe about 115 years ago, and he for a time lived in a sod house.
Uh-huh.
But nowadays we have building codes and all kinds of land use regulations, and many people support making these regulations even stricter in the name of progressivism or even in the name of environmentalism. So how was this person able to build this earthen house that I think is a good idea if that's what he wanted to do, but our government doesn't want to let us do these kinds of things?
Yes, he was able to do it because he's in far rural northeastern Oregon. So well, they don't have that particular land use regulation. In western Washington, about the only place you can do that, I believe, is Lewis County. And they may be tightening up now. You're right. You know, the zoning regulations, the building code regulations are indeed being tightened up. We can theorize about why, but it wouldn't do any good. Essentially, what we have to do is whatever we can. Okay, we go as far as we can. And if we bump up against the regulations, well, we'll try to flow like water around them.
Hi, yeah. David, Jonathan. I built a house on the north end of Bainbridge Island, and I did a lot of things that were illegal at the time, and now they're legal.
Oh.
And it's partly because I think you have to really push the edges on even those building codes that seem so formidable.
Uh-huh.
And just do it because it's the right thing to do.
Okay.
And you know, yeah, it makes for a much more challenging project if you do it that way. But I think you have to kind of pick and choose and say, this is more responsible. And so that's why I'm doing it. And just keep pushing. And yes, pick and choose. Certainly, pick your battles. You can't fight everything.
So.
Actually, my question is in reference to other cultures that are not represented here.
Sure.
What kind of engagement is occurring with those communities to teach and support this, where in such a diversity as our greater Seattle, in terms of immigrant populations that come from countries where they lived like that,
right,
potentially, and now they want a different lifestyle of things,
yeah.
How do you then reverse that, being that they are becoming the majority?
Okay, Todd, is the mic picking that up? Okay. Well, I can't speak for anybody but myself on this, but I teach environmental science at Highline, where most of my students are not majority culture. A few are immigrants, most are international students. But in both cases, I find myself opening people's minds in exactly that way, because we mostly talk about the general principles of environmental science and how you see them going in nature, but the last couple weeks of the course, we are indeed dealing with questions like that, and we run one particular exercise where I have them they're in groups of four. I have each group analyze a product, any kind of product, like a shoe or a bicycle or whatever, and just kind of mentally take it apart and then analyze each part of it back to the ground. Where did this come from? How did it get there? What was, where did it originate with either plants or with something mined out of the ground? And then eventually, they trace it up to where it gets to the factory and gets manufactured and then gets shipped and then they pick it up at the store. And it's quite an enlightening exercise for anybody, really, but these folks who've never ever thought about this, no one has ever brought up these issues before, all of a sudden they start thinking differently about it. Many of them do say, they come out afterwards saying, they do indeed still want that high consumption lifestyle because it's been sold to them. Okay, but they at least have a chance to be critical of it, at least have a chance to think about it. I don't know of any other such efforts. Perhaps other environmental science teachers are doing something similar, haven't heard. But you're right, it's an excellent point to be considering. I don't know.
John.
Well, I think a lot of this is not so much material as what I'd call status seeking and feeling valued versus not valued. And so selling our lifestyle is basically telling the world, we're the greatest, we're number one. And if you're not, then there's something wrong with you. And that gets to your psyche, so it's more than just material things. It's pecking orders, that kind of thing. That's a hard one to deal with. I mean, I believe our ancestors dealt with it. But that's, upward mobility, equal opportunity, that's, it's all based on this ladder and you gotta climb and I don't know what I'm saying. I'm just saying it's part of the whole equation.
Thanks.
I don't know if I missed this. I was standing at a bus stop because it takes three buses to get over here now. But I wonder if you had addressed the Kennewick Man issue with any students, or how that's been something that's apparently been around as an issue for a long time, and some Native peoples as far away as Minnesota have been very, very interested in the subject. But have you done any research on what's on that whole situation?
I was taking a different focus for this presentation. That's more kind of cultural identity and how long have Native Americans been here?
We know apparently they're saying now 9,000 years is
right.
But I mean apparently this was a problem with some of the people who moved in the 1800s.
Yeah.
So I'm hands off the whole situation because I did not move to Seattle until I was over 30. And it never occurred to me to usurp the Native culture in any way whatsoever. But apparently that's part of the issue, is that people have been saying we want to help the Native people, but it's hard to understand what they want from us. And I think what you're partly saying is maybe they just want to be left alone. That's kind of what briefly that I got here.
Okay. Well, I am not going to try to speak for Native Americans. However, what I perceive my proper role to be based on my interactions with them is supplying help to show up at their events, and be not only be polite but behave the way they want their audience members to behave, which, you know, there are expectations. For example, not taking pictures of certain ceremonies. So I'll behave in accordance with their cultural norms. I come to their events and show that I appreciate their culture without appropriating it, without making it my own thing that I will then profit from. I will never try to take over or even join a group that I don't properly belong to. Okay. And when they express a powerful need, for example, upholding their treaty rights, I will support it with everything I have. Because they said they wanted it. I want to support it. That's enough, you know? I'm not going to, well, okay. And anything else I say would just be repeating. The big thing is not to be the great white savior. Okay, I do have some technical knowledge, and I've put it to use for organizations where they wanted it. But I've not come in and said, you know, I'm the great expert. You know, do what I say. That's very inappropriate. In fact, there were times at CCEJ where they would ask me to come up on stage, and I wouldn't, because I wanted the focus to be on the people of color who were the leadership. That's not my place. I'm a helper. I'm staying in the background. That's what's appropriate.
I don't know what CCHA is.
Oh, Community Coalition for Environmental Justice. I talked about that at the very beginning.
Sorry.
Yeah.
Mary.
Yeah. I just wanted to share something and then ask a question.
Sure.
I'd like to share the fact that when you think of hanging stuff on the line, the image in your mind goes like this. This is the line. And these are the shoulders, and they go like this.
Uh-huh.
Well, there's such a thing as a clothespin.
Right.
And if you put a bunch of clothespins, you can hang things this way.
Mm-hmm.
And it multiplies how much you can hang on a line incredibly. So with only, say, two lines of this length, you know, it's all done.
Right.
And you can... What I'm interested in is the fact that I would hope that people start to think about creating maybe enclosing porches a bit, figuring out ways so that I still have a washer and dryer and I'm not going to get rid of them, but the dryer will last forever because it gets used for 2 minutes, which is as long as it takes to take. You throw everything in the dryer, and the time it takes to put things that don't go in the dryer ever, to put them on racks,
right.
That's as long as the stuff in the dryer gets, and then it gets hung up in this way, and it's saved a terrific amount. But what I really wanted to get into is that here in Seattle, we are going to be, you know, stacked like sardines in both directions really fast, because we're in the perfect climate in the whole world. And people are moving here. So I really am happy to see that there are things like that you can invest in solar not on your house, that you can, mm-hmm. you know, your house, you know, you have no exposure. You're actually, you want to grow trees to soak up the carbon, right? I do. I want to have deciduous trees, especially on the west and south sides of my house. And so anyway, being able to invest so that the solar panel is someplace else,
mm-hmm.
but that I'm contributing to distributed rather than centralized energy.
Right.
And what I'm thrilled about is that that trend is really taking off like crazy. The solarization and the adoption of non-renewable sources of energy is going much faster than it was expected to go. So that's just, I'm just saying, you know, we aren't going to be in places where we can do everything,
right.
but we can invest in a way.
Yeah, I guess my main point would be just be on the lookout. I think most of us are already, but keep in mind, as you're looking for things, check it out and make sure that the solution is not worse than the problem.
You don't want mold in your house.
Right. Well, I'm thinking about things like hybrid cars. you know, which most of the people who buy hybrid cars are only buying them because they get better gas mileage. Okay. You know, what if they were looking for, I hesitate to call it pure, but something that, some kind of vehicle that really is focused even more on saving energy in its manufacture, on being recyclable in every part, those kinds of things. I don't hear that from Toyota, you know, or Honda, or Hyundai, or any of them. Ruud.
I'm kind of going to that point as well in terms of batteries. People forget the special minerals needed for any of our batteries and any of our technology, although small, in exponential terms, is just becoming so contaminated that, and then you have all this electronics stuck. You're stuck with it in your home because it continuously needs to be upgraded because society forces you to have to upgrade to bank, to be online at school, to be a student. Everything is going mobile. You know, so how do you push back enough to stay engaged, but at the same time, government, society, institutions, forcing you to have to do it this way. I say this especially as a young person, where I'm seen as an old woman because I push back. But how do you balance it in terms of staying engaged enough? But I'm seeing it; it's becoming even more exponential.
Thanks. Todd,
going back to the big picture, the end of your talk there, what it's a person can do as a response to the whole, you know, the whole big picture.
Right.
You know. The situation with planned obsolescence of our cell phones, they tell you it's going to be a year and a half and then you're going to have to buy a new one. That's one example. The thing about how we can save energy with the indoor hanging of our, instead of using the door. So there's a thousand things. My response has been, you know, as a whole person, I started out just in rebellion in 2003. So I burned my CPA license and I refused to be part of the Western economy because of war. Not because of my virtue or anything, because what I was doing was, I couldn't live that way anymore. So then I went through years of evolution, because I was a pretty dumb guy, socially and environmentally and spiritually, and I did years of protest. And about 5 years ago, you know, I started making video. And the reason I'm telling you this is because I feel that the whole big problem is so big that we need to just have a lot of general awareness, raising awareness of a lot of subjects by experts and people who can speak clearly. Like your presentation is a great example. And so I'm just going to wrap up, since it was about indigenous people. I have found, you know, I go around and shoot video on a weekly basis, and I filmed the United Hood March a couple of days ago. Now, this was a bunch of African-American people. Many didn't know each other. Many of them had hostilities and misunderstandings and what it was to get gangs to stop their hostility and to unite around the issues that are important for African-Americans in Seattle. Well, I'm just telling you this because they hugely appreciate being videoed and put up on cable TV and on the internet. And then they link to it and they talk about it, and they listen to what the other people said, and they argue about what was said, and it contributes to a general fertilization, you know. And so also I've been to that Duwamish Longhouse, again, not because I knew anything about it, but because people told me to go and film this, you know, and so I went to film it. It was Jack Evans, you know, the Poets West guy. He made me go down and film things down there. And so people drag you into things that you'd never know about if you get into media work. And then, so what I'd like everyone to consider that, you know, I'm not a geek or a photographer or anything, but just get a camera that's running on fully automatic focus, automatic light, automatic sound level. Really, all you do is you push the red start button, and it just sucks up a broadcast quality signal, you know, pictures. And they have been broadcast to some millions of people that have watched a single video. You know, so it has potential. So if all of us would do that and get out to the tribes, get out to the demonstrations, get out to Shell Mill, and get out to the south half of Seattle, which has all these rich, you know, black and other, cultures. And just, that's where I donate my time. I mean, it's easy to ride a bike and not be part of the industrial civilization. That's easy. Right. Mm-hmm. Eat beans, you know. He lives on 5,000 a year. I live on 5,000 a year. That's easy. Mm-hmm. Shoot, there's all kinds of people living in a tent city and less than that.
They're considered homeless, by the way. Mm-hmm. A person living in tent city is a homeless.
Right, but they're not making an impact on the society unless you, and we can, because we know how to get out and create content, as Jonathan's doing. That is really great. That's what's short. There's a shortage of real content. And then the other thing is, get in there and make a video of it and put it on YouTube. Those are the two things that are going to take over the media, that are going to change the culture, and amplify our progress.
That environmental context between those of us who are trying to get people to be housed in affordable housing and getting services that they need so that they get the opportunity to deal with their post-traumatic stress disorder because they've been homeless, and perhaps get the opportunity to change their lifestyle, but we can't force them to do it. Those people, in other words, the healthcare community, is kind of at this point sometimes at odds with the people who say, homeless by choice is not a bad idea, really. Maybe it's okay to live in the middle of nowhere, but you know, it's like, I doubt that unless I went with a bunch of other people, I doubt that I'm ever gonna live, hopefully I will never have to live out in the middle of nowhere and wildcraft. But I mean, I'd be willing to do that if there was a major catastrophe. But just one point, if I have a landline, I do not have a cell phone, a landline will work in case of major disaster, will be the only one that will. Theoretically, I was told by the government that I'm maybe the only person in the building that I live in that has a landline that could be used for getting medical help for someone who might need it in case of a major earthquake or something.
Okay. Wait, Karen, you brought up an interesting point, which is that a lot of us in European American society think we have to do things ourselves. But tribal people don't do that. They're always with their friends. Just keep that in mind, too. Because I don't like to tell people what to do. I just like to put ideas out there and let people put together their own solutions, because I know you will. Okay? But do keep in mind that idea that we can do a lot more. Well, it's the idea of synergy. You know, 2 + 2 = 5. If you're really working on a project together, you get the flow going, you can produce more than the individuals on their own could do.
Bert. I was thinking, based on Todd's comment about things to do, I did something I'd like to share with people because I think it was a useful thing to do.
Uh-huh.
On Wednesday in the morning at 7:30, there was a conference going on in the Renaissance Hotel downtown, 6th and Madison. And the conference was a 2-day conference for people who were going to be profiting from the drilling of the Arctic.
Right. Mm.
So there were a bunch of people who were already protesting, and I had a sign that came down. But I did something unusual for me. I got dressed up. And I got off my sneakers, and I put on black shoes. I've tried to look presentable, like somebody that could talk his way into the conference. At least what I wanted to do was to talk to somebody who was in the conference. I was going to buy them coffee or even breakfast if they'd sit and talk with me and explain to me their position of why they're doing what they're doing. Well, I didn't get that far because it was early. They had coffee upstairs. And I got up to the top, and this guy in a brown suit, a bit unpleasant to me, I thought, so this is a private conference, there's no public information available, and unless you pay $500, you can't come in. So I couldn't do much, so I went down, went to the coffee shop, nobody there. I went outside, and there was a two camera crews, Como and Cairo, and they were filming outside. And I said, you know, why don't you go inside and see if you can get somebody to talk from the other side? Because it's a mistake we often make. We see people as the enemy. And if we really want to make progress, we need to see that people who we can disagree with are human. The enemy is human. Everything can change. So they went in. There's a guy that came down who was, his name is Peter Phillips from Phillips Publishing, who was the front guy who hosted the conference. And he talked to the media people. And the media people asked a good question, one good question, which is climate change going to be on your agenda for 2 days? And he said, no, it isn't. So then it broke up and I said, could I ask you another question, Mr. Phillips? He gave me his card. And I said, you believe in climate change? Is it a real human-based phenomenon? And he said, well, and I'm trying to recollect my judgment of him. And I think in that situation, maybe he does believe what he said, which is, well, there are natural fluctuations in the climate, and that's all that's going on. Whether he said that because he really believed it, or he said that because he felt in his position he had to say something like that, I don't know yet. But I got his card, and I'm thinking what things to send him. But so there are 2 points. And the second one I'll get very briefly is what I'll send him. But the first one is how useful it was for me, because I had a certain fear of going to talk to the other side. And that's a fear that keeps us from doing the peacemaking that we need to be doing. And it was good to see, to talk to him and to be civil and have him be civil. When I said to him, I'm glad they came in because I didn't want you people to be seen as the enemy. And he smiled, and I smiled back at him. And the other thing I'm going to send him, I think, it's a reference for people. If you want somebody credible to present this information, I think I'm going to send him something that I'd sent to Bruce Ramsey a couple of years ago. I happened to come across again. The World Bank is headed by a guy who used to be with, in Haiti.
Partners in Health. Partners in Health.
Yes, he used to work with Partners in Health, exactly. And then he became president of Dartmouth College. And then he became president of the World Bank. And he begins his preface to 3 major papers that the World Bank puts out, the World Bank now, where he says, my hope is that this paper will shock everyone into action. And then the papers talk about not only 2 degrees and what that will be like, but we're headed for 4 degrees by the end of the century, the way things are going. And I'm going to send that to this guy and try and do it in as kind a way, as peaceful a way as I can, because I see that as part of my practice on myself. Oh, one last question, completely different subject, just like asking. Ashkenazi, is that the name of the area?
No, that's the ethnic group. That's there are two major divisions in European Judaism. One is the Sephardim, who initially ended up in Spain and then were kicked out by the Inquisition in 1492. Mostly ended up in Turkey and nearby areas. And then the Ashkenazim, who were, that's actually a word that means German.
In what language?
Yiddish. So it's the Central European Jews, basically. And a website I saw today said that we're all 33rd cousins. Everybody's who's Ashkenazi Jewish, yeah.
Oh.
Kathy.
Yeah, we used to talk about third world leadership, and we don't much. It's not a term that comes around much anymore. Mm-hmm. But I think that cultures that aren't as wealthy as ours are far more resilient, because, in part because people understand they have to help each other. There's no other way out. And people are also so intelligent and creative at getting by on very little, which we have gotten very bad at. We, buy an appliance. I mean, we buy appliances to do things that I never imagined one needed an appliance to do.
Like a vacuum cleaner.
Or fluff your milk. Fluff your milk, you know, those little milk fluffer, battery-powered objects. And it's so helpful to watch and learn and ask for help from people who have simpler ways of solving problems and bring a different viewpoint. And I think the single most important thing that I do to build community where I live is ask for help. If I am out of sugar in the middle of cooking something that needs sugar, I go around with my cup to my neighbors before I go to the store. You know, and I think it's and then my neighbors feel perfectly free to come to me because I've been to them. And there are so many different ways to solve problems, and asking for help solving the problem is one way of finding that. And you know, I love to have the answers. You know, that's what they taught me, to have the answers. And so it's a little hard to do.
I was always taught to pay for experts to do stuff. But as one gets older and lives on a limited income, as I do, I can't afford to pay an expert to do anything. And I just figure, you know, it doesn't need to be done.
Yeah. Well, as Kathy was saying, we have lost our sense of use it up, wear it out, make it do or do without, which my U.S. history textbook told me was the basis of American development in the 19th century. People had that attitude. They were building for...
You think you need something, just wait a while. See if it doesn't, the desire tends to go away after a while.
Totally. Closely related to that is sharing the tools. And it's ridiculous to have every house all up and down the city has their own lawnmower and their own hedge clippers. And
uh-huh.
You know, they use it one time a month or something. And I'm glad you're doing the car sharing is a great example. You know, all these idle cars sitting around and people would just share. And share our space, for example. Why does everybody have to have a completely separate property with a completely separate fence around and everything, you know? And
that's only 61% of the population.
I'm sorry, I didn't want to
family.
Get started again.
61% here in Seattle, 61% in King County. I don't know about King County, but that's more than 50%, though, right. Have their own houses.
Yeah. Okay, thanks. I just want to make sure that anyone else who had a question hasn't had a chance gets their chance now, because we only have a couple minutes left. Fred.
Yeah, Mary talked about the threat of zillions of people flooding here.
I don't see the threat, I see it as a reality. Mm-hmm.
Okay. I don't feel so much concerned about the population as a problem. What I'm more concerned about is the culture. Way too often we try to fix the thing that's not broken, and the thing that is broken keeps on being broken. So lots and lots of people bought hybrid cars because gas was so expensive, and now gas was cheap, so they drove more. And their gas consumption went up compared to when they had a great big SUV.
That's right.
And the size of the average American house has increased by 2.5 times in the past 50 years. So no matter what you do, it's going to cost 2.5 times as much to heat it, to light it, to whatever. as that old house, which in turn was quite a bit bigger than the houses of 1900. There was a time, and in most of the world it's still the case, that the notion of a bedroom is a luxury. And now there absolutely has to be one bedroom per person in our modern analysis of things. So we go around trying to fix the technology, And the culture keeps on accepting those fixes and driving forward. So I guess my question is, how do we fix the culture? And now you're having a minute.
Well, this is a lot of what I'm doing with my teaching, with my talking with people, with the kind of activism that I do, which is mostly this kind of thing in conversations with people and showing up at other people's events and occasionally bringing up ideas. That's how I do it. Other people, you know, use the media. You know, I'm terrible at that. But I am a librarian, so I can recommend books to people. I haven't yet developed a book list for this talk, but I will if you want. There's certainly plenty out there. Mary.
Yeah, I just want to make a big shout out for the public libraries. I don't own a computer. I go to the library. On a good day, it's a nice walk. There's one, a reasonable walk. On a bad day, I'll get there, probably drive there in my 93 Geo Metro. But anyway, I really love going to the library because every time I go, I have to see those children whose future is in my hands. They're undeniable. There they are, you know. And it's a different mix of them each time. But it solves my problem. It limits me to an hour and a half a day of being online. Now, I realize if you're a student, blah, blah, blah. I mean, for a lot of people, this isn't going to work. But I think for a lot of people, they just think you have to have a cell phone. I'm like Karen. I do not have a cell phone. I have 4 landlines. I love Princess phones. I have an old red one that says Bell System Property, not for sale. I love that thing. I mean, you could throw that phone across the room and it wouldn't break. It's amazingly resilient. And yeah, so I don't feel deprived at all. And people say, when are you going to get a cell phone? Or when are you going to get a computer? I said, when I need to. And that's honest. But I think the idea is when you need something and you know you need it, then you buy it. Same thing, my business is gardening out of the Geo Metro. Do you need a truck to garden? I don't believe that a Clippers requires a truck. When everybody has this huge green bin, you know, that they put the yard waste in, or else they have a combination with worm bins and compost piles and so forth and so on. So it's not like everybody should be like me. I'm not saying that, but it's just that principle that you mentioned. The mower, the idea that you have to have, if you mow, a gas mower or some fancy mower. I have a mower that I bought for $25 at a garage sale. My neighbors borrow that mower. It's hidden behind some bushes because they borrow it so often. Because people like the sound of a rotor, you know, of the blades going around. And it doesn't have to be all that perfect. But it's just this mentality of feeling less than. I think that's the trick, is to not feel less than when you use less, or when you use older, or when you don't use the latest model, or when you use something slower. To not feel less than, that doesn't make you less than. The fact that you rent your clothes from the Goodwill, that means you give them away to the Goodwill, and then you get some when you need it, and give it back. I mean, it's just a nice rental system. You don't need to buy a clothes. But the point is that in Seattle, I think we can break a lot of these sort of, the garbage that comes in from TV, that sort of model of life. I think we have a big opportunity to not conform to that and be okay.
Okay, Rosie.
I think that climate justice demands of us even more than our changes in our particular life. It demands us stepping out into the political arena. It demands us stepping out into the world arena where we try to divest ourselves from our gas companies if we have retirement savings in them. We try to get our churches and our schools to divest. We support people like the Bayan group, which is a Filipino people who are probably the first generation that are here in the U.S. and are working really hard to raise awareness about their islands disappearing under the ocean and the typhoons. And I love all this. It's so nice to be able to do these changes, and we need to do a more worldly thing as well.
Okay. Yep. Well, as the Power Past Coal campaign asked, you know, if we keep bombarding our legislators with our messages, they have to respond at some level. They can keep on ignoring us for a while, but eventually, if enough people are doing it, they will indeed have to respond.
Well, either respond or be replaced.
Yeah.
People can, you know, you start to pile up the vote. How did they vote on
Fast
Track and so forth?
Yeah. Speaking of which, there the Port Commission has a couple of positions open, and there's a, I believe it's the evening of the 29th, there's a public forum on that at Town Hall on the candidates who are running for Port Commission. They would be really interesting to go there and see what they have to say about stuff like Shell. You know, what is the port's impact on the environment? It's not just diesel exhaust from the trucks, although that's very important. There's a whole bunch of other things too. It would be really great if some FOR folks would show up there. I know other people will too. Okay, oh, we're running over time here. Huh? Okay, well, I want to thank you very much.